Good morning, church. It's a pleasure for us to be here this morning to give all glory to God. He has been faithful to us, my family, and I can say the church at large, because in a trying moment, God was there and the church was there with us. Hallelujah. Sometime last year, January, my wife caught COVID, and it was so serious. Around the 16th of January, they took her to Civic Hospital, and there, that night, the doctor actually said it was just 5% chances for her to live. Yeah, they called me that night. And since that night, it was just ups and downs, ups and downs, that actually it was not all that easy. So that night, they went through, and the morning, she was a bit stable, that they had to transfer her to Mount Sinai, downtown Toronto, because the government said this hospital was like full or was just an emergency point. When someone is almost like stable, they'll transfer her. So okay, they chose that Mount Sinai was the best place for her to go. And there they tried, and it was not all that easy. For about 3 months, she was on oxygen constantly. And they were just like trying to bring her to stable, normal, and it was always like on, off. So within the 3 months, I was not even able to see her. Where just like the highest they could do was FaceTime over the internet. So I would see her. And from there, we were just like praying. The first day, I just called the brethren, text them, and told them that this is the situation, and they were praying. And the pastors also, they were like calling, praying, and sending support, because I can say without that, I could not have done it myself, but God did it. And there was even a time that she was like almost coming out of the coma, or I can say the oxygen, that they transfer her to the normal floor. And from the normal floor, it was not really like stable. And there, she was like losing the breath again. So just one night at the normal floor, they had to rush her back to the ICU, where she was still on oxygen. And from there, it was almost like 3 months again. And with that, they had to put the trachea is something they put on the throat, because they discovered that she could not breathe normally, because they tried that she could like breathe normally, but it was not going. So they had to open the throat and put the trachea there. And now that was another point of challenge. And the point of challenge was that they said when they put the trick, there was no way to remove it. Yeah. So she was to live with it for life. But we thank God, because God did it in a way that no man could have even doubted God. And today, she's not with a trick, and she can speak. Hallelujah. So I would just like you to hear from her again.
Praise the Lord. I am really very grateful to God for that which he has done in my life, because I don't know what to say. There were many people who also got COVID-19, but they died. But even though my case was critical, God saw me through. He kept me alive. And one thing I always say is that if you can wake up in the morning and talk to someone and the person hears you, it's something to praise God. It is when you don't have that ability to speak that you will know the importance of thanking God that you're able to speak. When I had the trach on, I couldn't talk. I couldn't make a sound. But you know in your heart you really want to express yourself, you cannot, because you cannot speak. Even if you speak, no one will hear you. So all the time I was writing all the time. Everything I want to communicate, I'll put it in writing. So at one point they gave me I don't really know the name of it, but a device to put it on my soft spot that can amplify my sound. So I felt that if I have to accept that, it means that I'm accepting the fact that I will never speak again in my life. So I told the doctor that I don't want it because I will not get tired communicating through writing than that I want to say something. I have to start searching for a soft spot where I can place a device to amplify the sound. And it will not even amplify the sound in such a way that you would understand, because it sounds like it's a robot speaking. So I told the doctor I don't want it because it would just limit my faith to believe that God can make me talk again. When I had the trach, I even pleaded with the doctor. I said, but what is the real issue? He told me that my vocal cords have collapsed. Now, even if the trach is taken out, I will not be able to speak because my vocal cords have collapsed. And the narrowing of the trachea is from the top and at the bottom. So it cannot be corrected surgically. I just have to remain with the trach for life. But when he said that, I said, my God will do it for me. Because that's your report. That's the doctor's report. That was not the report of the Lord for me. I pleaded that, please, can't you just do a surgery? He told me that it cannot be corrected surgically, that I desire it to be. But I didn't know that God was planning to do it in his own way, that I would not even go through surgery. Because the day that I had, after the prayers we prayed, I went back to, I called the doctor and said, when am I coming for the appointment? He instead directed me to a different doctor in Toronto General Hospital. So the day I went to that general hospital, the doctor he did a bronchoscopy and told me that the airway was open and that he would take out, I should come back the next, he gave me like 1 week, that there was a little narrowing which is still there, which he can place a balloon there to keep it open. But when I went for him to do that, the airway was completely open, so he didn't need to do any surgery to add anything, but he just took out the trach, and immediately he took it out, I was able to speak. Besides, even having the trach, was a very, it was not comfortable at all. It was not a good moment. It was very, it is something that you can die even at any time. Because at one point, when the doctor told me to come to downsize the trach, when he downsized the trach, I went back to that day, I was just feeling uncomfortable. I complained to the nurses, I said, I'm not okay. They told me that because they have downsized the trach, that is how he reacts. I said, no, you don't understand because I am not breathing. I am not breathing. They just told me if you want this thing to be taken out, you have to persevere. So I thought I'd persevere. I didn't know that I died that night. I woke up and I saw myself, I think 2 days later, I was in a different hospital when I was already in the rehabilitation for preparing to go back home. I discovered I was now in a different hospital, and they told me I was in St. Michael because I had a cardiac arrest. Because as they downsized the trach, the secretion was piling up, so air could not go through my lungs, so it caused my heart to stop beating. But in all, I give God glory because I came out with my sanity. I didn't lose my sanity. I know everything, I know everybody, and I did not. My people, they tried to ask me several times that, do you know this? I said, yes, I know everything. But people, some people don't even come out with their sanity. But God kept me and brought me back out in one piece.
Hallelujah. It's really something, because actually the doctors were really like telling me everything, and I went to my family doctor when they did when the cardiac arrest actually happened. So the doctor confirmed that we should just prepare, because it's something that when everybody goes through that point, he's either a vegetable or just in a state that the person will not recognize anybody. That's what the doctor told me. Well, I just said, well, we are just praying, because he just said, okay, let's just be praying and hoping that miracle can happen. That was the doctor's saying, that something can happen. We don't know. But from their report, nobody goes through that hours of cardiac arrest and come back and be normal. So they printed the report and gave me. I just said, well, I just communicated also to the brethren, and they were praying, the pastors were praying. So after maybe a month or so, they were able to like see that things were recovering somehow. They were always like testing her pulse, and they discovered that it was like responding. So they were saying that, wow, in the hospital, even they were saying that it's a miracle, that we could not believe that this is happening. So every step was like they were marveled. Even at the end of the day, not to keep you long, the end of the day that even they removed the thing, all the doctors were like, this is amazing, that we have never seen this before. So when she even came back home and they had to call even the rehab was like shouting. They put microphone speakers everywhere, and the whole place was like celebrating that, wow, what is this? We can hear your voice. And they were like, say, wow, because they could not believe that it could happen. But God did it for us. Hallelujah. We just thank God for that. So we just want to thank the church. We don't have much to say, but all glory goes to our Father who is in heaven. Hallelujah.
And I want to thank each and every one of you here, because when I came out of the hospital, I received a gift from the church. And I equally thank everyone for your support, prayer, financially and spiritually. So we just want to appreciate you and thank you.